Since spring 2015, El Niño conditions have developed in the tropical Pacific Ocean. El Niño is recognized by unusually warm waters at and below the surface in the eastern tropical Pacific, but it's actually a much broader atmosphere ocean fluctuation that involves slackened trade winds, eastward shifted tropical clouds, and precipitation patterns across the tropical Pacific, along with warmer waters and higher sea levels that spread poleward along the west coast of North and South America. El Niño brings an enormous change in the amount of heat and moisture that is transferred from the tropical Pacific to the atmosphere, and this affects weather patterns on a global scale. Here on the California coast, we may see heightened sea levels, high ocean waves, and sometimes heavy precipitation. Throughout history, strong El Niños have caused destruction to coastlines, floods, droughts, ecosystem shifts, and other disturbances that have afflicted regional economies, fisheries, and agriculture. A handful of pioneering scientists, including Tim Barnett here at Scripps Institution of Oceanography, UC San Diego, began to study and model El Niño in the 1970s. More broadly, the quest to fully understand El Niño was highlighted to the public when a very large El Niño developed in 1982. Although this was one of the most destructive El Niños in modern history, it arrived almost unnoticed.
A couple of us, one here, one at Lamont, developed mathematical, more sophisticated mathematical models for El Niño prediction. And they worked out really pretty well. The first one, however, that was done in 82-83. And at that time, there was a gathering of the U.S. El Niño prediction experts, all seven or eight of us. We had a meeting because things were strange in the tropics.
In 1982, observations and our ability to forecast El Niño was still in an early phase of development. In summer that year, the initial data stream indicated exceptionally warm tropical Pacific waters, but it was so much warmer than average conditions that the data were rejected. Weeks later, after persistently warm ocean temperatures kept appearing, the data were correctly taken seriously, and it was recognized that a mighty event was underway.
In fact, there, as Klaus Herke said, there will be no El Niño this year. And he slammed his fist down and sort of ended the meeting. Well, of course, a month later, we realized we were in the middle of the biggest event of the century. A lot of new funding came in, and the two groups I mentioned, one Lamont, one here, developed numerical prediction models for El Niño. And tried them out on the big one of 1987-88, I think, and nailed it. It was beautiful.
By the 1990s, our capability to detect El Niños had improved substantially. In summer 97, when signs of another major El Niño were appearing, Scripps Oceanography began to sound the alarm and notify the public that an active winter was likely in store. The next few months were nerve-wracking. We had gone out on a limb with the prediction, but North Pacific and California weather patterns in the early winter were relatively calm. So the public and the media began to murmur that we had sounded a false alarm. Finally, in late January 1998, North Pacific storms arrived in full force, and we saw our most active winter since the 1982-83 El Niño winter.
The 97-98 El Niño was the biggest one in the past, say, 50 or 60 years. But the 82-83 El Niño was the biggest one before that, and we had a lot more coastal damage in California during the 82-83 El Niño, even though it was smaller. And the reason is because the storms during that El Niño happened to come during high tide. So there was a lot of coastal damage as these storms came. They raised local sea levels, and the waves came crashing onto shore. So it's a lot of damage. So to some extent, the degree of damage you get from an El Niño is somewhat of chance whether or not the storms come when the tide is high. When we make our forecasts, we use a number of different data sources. There's a string of buoys across the tropical Pacific that measure both at the surface and below the surface, which is really useful for initializing our models. And then there's satellites, which give us temperatures across the whole tropical Pacific Ocean. And those are the main data sources we use when we initialize our model.
This year, 2015, we are seeing signs of an event that is nearly as strong as any we've seen in the last 60 years. Scientists at Scripps Institution of Oceanography have developed and produced an array of tools that we didn't have during the last great El Niños. These developments allow us to track the present El Niño and its impacts with much better coverage and greater detail. This network, which was instituted shortly after the 97-98 El Niño, now contains about 4,000 floats that cover every ocean basin and transmits data in nearly real time to scientists throughout the world.
We have newer ways to observe the ocean, one of them being profiling floats, as in the Argo array. And something we've done over the past 2 years, especially Dean Remick, has put out another 40 some odd floats at the equator. And then almost 10 years ago, we started a project to use underwater gliders to observe the local responses to large-scale climate variability like El Niño. We started this because we know that a lot of the climate variability we see locally is caused by forces far away, like at the equator. So we have gliders that go back and forth along three lines, repeating those lines roughly every 3 weeks, and they've been doing that since 2006.
As this year's event develops, Scripps Oceanography has been a central player in deploying and demonstrating the power of continuous oceanic observations. The autonomous devices that are making it possible to observe the El Niño are a cost-effective technology that has led to new understanding and increased global predictive capacity. To sustain this network, however, new federal investments are crucially needed. This network is vital to helping communities plan for and cope with environmental events and longer period changes. Understanding how to adapt to El Niño and other future weather extremes will require a collective effort that goes beyond our community of scientists. This year, we are looking for the public's help as well.
The existing El Niño has raised concerns about the effects of energetic waves along the shoreline. Through SCOOS, we hope to engage the public to actually help us document some of the damage that will be done, or potentially that could be done, during this system. We have developed several products, and one of them is actually this flooding index, which gives a 3-day indication to the general public of what the conditions are along the shoreline.
We publish a thing locally called the El Niño Index, which is a measure of temperature from our underwater gliders. A lot of people use it to see what the local temperature is in response to climate variability.
We're always trying to find a way that we can really talk to the people who make the decisions about emergency management, water management, fire management for that matter. And, try to communicate to them the forecast in the way that's most useful for them.
And earlier this year, Scripps Oceanography launched a new coordinated effort called the Center for Climate Change Impacts and Adaptation. This center will draw together expertise of ocean and climate scientists with that of social scientists, engineers, educators, and others. The center's mission is to help society make informed decisions about adaptation to climate change.
When one thinks about the future, where are we going as a field? There's a tremendous need for climate information, long-term planning, and so on. And to do it right, you need not only to be able to predict what the ocean or the atmosphere are doing, but what associated things are doing. How is the soil or the beach littoral cell going to react to a major change in climate or wave conditions? So with this new center that we have, I think it's an excellent opportunity to construct a model, something like that, almost a business model, if you want, that gets us from good El Niño prediction down to what the sea level rise is going to be at the La Jolla shores this winter.
This year's El Niño presents us with great challenges, but it's an enormous opportunity. The scientific understanding that we're developing at Scripps is allowing us to put information to work that should improve public safety and help plan for future changes.